Good morning, everyone. Wow, what a live audience we have in the room today. I was amazed at the number of questions that you had for the previous speaker. So let me start with a very, very short introduction of Harman and then move on to what we believe is the theme in the connected services world. Harman is a $6 billion company and headquartered in the US. We have been serving the infotainment space for 6 decades. We were the industry first in bringing a lot of technologies into cars. And today I'll talk about what we believe is in India and in the global markets for this connected technologies. So talking about the scenario in India in terms of the connected vehicle market. If you see, we started very small. We started with a few thousand vehicles, and we are approaching a critical mass. When I addressed a set of audience 2 years back, I expressed the concern that in India, the primary challenges that we have is connectivity and also the quality of maps. I think things have changed now. They are no more relevant for India. You have 100% 2G connectivity and a decent amount of 3G connectivity today. And we also have several map companies like here, Google, who have really baselined the maps for us to provide these services. So with those two problems behind us, if we look at what are the current problems that we have today, it's more on the size of the market itself, the size of the passenger and commercial vehicle market that we have in India, and also the take rate of options. People buy cars, but not all of them choose the highest variant of cars where you find the niche bleeding edge technology features. So those are some of the challenges. I would say the challenges have become smaller than earlier. We are approaching the tipping point. If I compare this with the global stream, in 2008, I would say it was mainstream in the US with telematics applications, 2G enabled telematics applications primarily. And we witnessed a lot of OEMs offering apps, and now they've become connected apps over 3G. And we also see them soon adopting 4G connectivity-based solutions by 2017. In the global market, by 2017, connectivity is a standard. By 2017, it's more like an ABS system in India. You will find them in most of the cars, and also the commercial vehicles. The challenge for us to solve here is, how are we going to make that meaningful to the end user, and how are we going to enable a stickiness for the user into these services? Otherwise, it's going to be just internet in India, nothing beyond that. The power of it comes on what amount of utilization is done on top of that platform. When I compare that with India, we are probably 3 to 4 years behind what's happening in the US and the Europe market, but we are catching up fast. What is relevant for today is the 3G connected apps. That's where the industry is progressing. By 2017, you will see some of the cars and consumers powered with these technologies. Moving on to global market, one of the things that Harman did is we initially started with solving this problem for India, while we had an independent team solving this problem for the global market. We realized that India doesn't go through the same serial fashion of technology adoption. We jump technologies. Before we have 100% 3G adoption, we will have 4G adoption. And the same is expected in cars. So you will see us not following the path linearly, but you will see us jumping and catching up with the US and the Europe trajectories very fast. So if you look at the global market, the connected cars is significant. It has grown beyond a point where tier one companies like us have rebranded ourselves as a connected company rather than calling ourselves as a hardware company. We have been systems companies for 6 decades, and in the 7th decade, we are calling ourselves the connected services company. That's because of the numbers that you see here. In 2020, you are expecting this to touch 400 million. So there'll be 400 million new cars that will be on the road, which will be connectivity enabled. And India will catch up with this connectivity technology much faster than other technologies. One of the reasons is that we have been very fast in adopting internet mainstream. The mobile internet, also the smartphone splurge that we had. So we believe that we will not go through a technology adoption line of ABS or airbags in India, but we will go through a smartphone pace of adoption in terms of connectivity inside cars. Talking about our presence here, today we have 20 million head units on the road globally, and a significant share of them are connectivity upgradable or already connected. And we have 3+ million users using our apps in the car space. And even for us, it's a challenge today to bring the stickiness and engagement that brings customers to us every day. So this is a problem that the industry is trying to solve on a whole, and all of us here will, in some form or shape, be contributing to the solution. We believe, as I told you, connectivity service is the next big thing. And that's one reason why, after a decade, we added the 4th division in Harman. For several years, we have been operating primarily with 3 divisions, the connected car, which talks about bringing the connectivity and the head unit capability inside a car, and lifestyle, which talks about bringing you consumer audio, and professional, which brings you the audio solutions for the audio producers. And we realized that our role doesn't end with bringing connectivity inside cars, but it starts there, and that's where we started the 4th division, which is connected services, with the acquisition of Symphony Telica, which is designed or planned to enable the users and the ecosystem players to leverage the connectivity inside car. Talking about the adoption timeline, how has this industry evolved? If you look at both in the US, Europe, as well as in India, all this started with niche applications. If we look at maybe 7 years back, in India you had telematics being adopted for complaints applications, primarily by ambulances, police, utility, and these kind of agencies were the first ones to adopt it. They had the luxury to try out few things, and they also had a mandate to upgrade in terms of technology. So they are the ones who started adopting these. And from there, it moved on to the enterprise applications. The applications like the fleet management solutions and driver monitoring solutions. So the industry, the enterprise industry, adopted it for improving their profitability or improving their performance. I would call we are approaching a new era, and the era is about addressing the end users, not really the enterprise or the government. And so today, we are talking about applications like eco-driving, the safety convenience features that we can deliver to the users. That is the critical mass, and that's where we see large momentum currently moving. We see the same reflected not only from our consumers, but also from OEMs, and as well as the other ecosystem players like operators, who strongly believe that the next big thing is the driver-focused connectivity solutions. It's also important to address everyone in the ecosystem. So that's the reason why there are solutions for the OEMs. So OEMs play a big role here. Though end users today are ready for evaluating and trying out these services, a big share of responsibility rests with the OEMs to make this technology available for the users to try. And that's why we believe that the CRM qualification, remote diagnostic services that can be extended to OEMs will incentivize them to bring this technology to the users. Talking about connectivity. So connectivity, what's connectivity? It's just probably internet. Internet inside your car cannot be a browser in your desktop. What do you do with connectivity? It doesn't become relevant unless it becomes part of your driving experience. And we believe that connectivity can play a major role in changing three things. Number one, the safety of the passengers who travel in the car. And the second one is the savings that we can provide to them. And the third one is the convenience that we can provide to them. In fact, when we look at India as a market in isolation, we believe that savings will drive things faster than safety and convenience. Talking about safety features, now connectivity can nurture new applications which can enable faster time to response in terms of emergency breakdown and things like that. And with the latest technologies like V2V becoming part of the telematics solution is going to again address more safety related features, reducing the number of accidents. You know, India is a different market. We need cooperative solutions, cooperative safety solutions rather than, standalone installed safety solutions. So that's where technologies like V2V will play a big role. And in terms of savings, again, if telematics or connected services can reduce the cost of ownership of a car or reduce the cost of using a car by 10 or 20%, that becomes a key point why consumers will look at this. And again, convenience, there's a huge expectation from the end users today. The demography of the car buyers is always lowering year after year. If the OEMs were targeting 40 plus as the age group for the luxury cars, now they have easily slashed that by 5 years. And what that means is that these audience have a different expectation out of the car. It's just not the seats, it's just not the way the car looks, but also the way the car interacts with them in terms of how content is delivered to them. Is it part of the connected lifestyle that they're living today? So that's where we believe three big domains where connectivity is expected to play a big role in India. Talking about some of the technology adoption line. So let's get into specifics. We are talking about safety, security, and a lot of these. But what does the consumer expect to see in his car? So we did a good amount of market research, and this data is compiled with inputs from our OEM colleagues, from our direct consumers in the solutions that we provide. And we see that in a year to come, you will see a lot of these solutions, the music, online connected music solutions, traffic services, roadside assistance, remote control apps, and driver training features becoming a standard mainstream application with every car. The OEMs have started taking the first steps. Most of them are in a piloting stage where they're trying these things out. And in a year or two from now, you will see them rolled out in a large scale. And we also believe that the timeline doesn't end here, but progress is still, active vehicle control, which is connectivity enabled, and advanced ADAS safety solutions, connectivity safety solutions, which will be the applications that will stay for a much longer time. As an ecosystem member, there are a couple of pain points that we need to solve today. So one of that is when we talk about bringing these services inside cars, this is very different from how connectivity apps proliferated in the smartphone world. In the smartphone world, you had a uniform platform strategy. So you could build an app for Android and then reach out to several million users. You can't do that today in cars. So though one side we are solving the problem of bringing connectivity inside cars, it's equally important to enable the ecosystem of service providers and content providers to be able to deliver content to this connected car. The second problem is the war between whether it's going to be services delivered through a telematics solution or will it be through a head unit. This is also an actively debated topic, and the industry is embracing both, but then we believe that the technology will lead in terms of head unit becoming connectivity enabled rather than having one more unit to enable that. And again, the capabilities of these telematics units and cars by itself is very different. We have OBD standards, which are slowly getting into mainstream. And even within OBD, when you look at the commercial vehicles as a segment, India is lagging behind in terms of the vehicle communication standardizations. So that's also a challenge for the industry, because the services that you write for one car will not be applicable for the other. And also the apps on for the cars. Yeah, there are few apps. Even if you look at the global market, you have smaller app ecosystems, and they haven't gained the traction. And we believe that there has to be a critical mass for OEMs to adopt. Now, when OEMs do a selection of their supplier for their connected services play, it's not going to be based on the telematics unit that they bring to the table. Telematics hardware is a commodity. It's no more a differentiator. And it's only going to be the price which is going to differentiate one supplier from the other. So what's the other thing which is going to differentiate them? It is really the bouquet of apps or services that the tier ones can bring to the table. Think of it, if there is one supplier who can bring 5 apps to the table and another supplier who can bring 5,000 apps to the table, and consumers, the end consumers are going to feel the impact of this connected technology only with the apps. So the industry and the tier ones have to look at building this critical mass so that OEMs are able to make better decisions. Again, the last challenge that we have is the Google and Apple dominance. This is again one more confusion point to the OEMs. Should we really build this by ourselves or wait for Apple and Google to solve this problem for us? Fair point. Now, Google, the CarPlay and so Google and CarPlay is becoming mainstream. And again, in cars from 2 years from now in India, you will see this technology is mainstream. The challenge here is that in the Google and Apple ecosystem, except for Google and Apple, others have less control on that. Now think of it, if this technology becomes the only mainstream focus area, all your cars will have a uniform experience. That's not something that the OEMs would want. They wouldn't want their lowest end of cars to have the very same experience of the highest end of their cars. Again, OEMs look for brand differentiation. They don't want consumers to have one single uniform experience where they lose their differentiation. So that's where it's important for OEMs to become part of this play and lead this rather than taking the backseat and waiting for somebody else to solve this. Now, let me park the topic of connectivity for a moment. Let's assume that this problem will be solved in a couple of years to come. This will already be solved in the developed markets, and even in India in 2 to 3 years' time, it will be solved. Now, what do you do with connectivity? So India or the global market today is looking at it with the 1.0 model, where they look at services being delivered as apps. So you have 2 apps today. You have a navigation app today, and you have a music app today, and that's what today is connected services. What we believe it'll lead to is the whole content and services delivered via platform. In the sense, you will not be adding apps, you will not be making your 2 apps 20 apps, or you will not be having an app clutter like what you have on your smartphone. Based on our research, consumers don't want to see 65 apps on their cars. They want to see the content within the few apps that they have. This is also important because the delivery of the content and services to a driver is a different problem than delivering it to a mobile user. The delivery is critical, and that's why Harman focuses on one of the technologies that we call as AHA Radio, where we deliver the music, news, and a lot of other content, including the social feeds, as radio, because radio is the most natural form of consuming content. This is just one example, but the direction in which the industry is moving is a model where you have few apps, and these apps becoming the platform for delivery of content and services. looking further beyond what we believe the industry will go to is a point where you don't have several apps, but you have one app that delivers the content live from the cloud. This will be realized after 4G becomes mainstream. But if you have to relate this to something that you do today, relate this to a television. You don't add apps. You don't add different kind of apps, or you don't interact differently. It is delivered via single app, single platform. So that's where we believe the industry will move, where the user turns on the head unit, and contextual data, contextual services are delivered to him via that one window, all becoming part of his lifestyle. One of the key challenges that is also slowing down adoption is the business models that we operate. So if you look at the traditional model, companies like us are looking at OEM as our target customer. So the primary goal is to go and milk the OEM. And OEMs have their own reservations in taking the first step forward and betting a lot of money in the space. And where that has to change is not to look at OEM as a customer, but look at OEM as a partner. There are several ways of monetizing the connected car. It need not be getting paid from the OEM alone. And there are several solutions that can be provided. Some of the names that you see here are members of this ecosystem who will be interested in funding and enabling the services. So it's important for us to invert the model where we look at OEM as a partner, where we do revenue share. Think of a model where every OEM is able to monetize their cars on the road. If OEM has 100 million cars, and if they're going to even make a few dollars a car every year, that's a big revenue stream for them. It's not too far that's going to happen. And very similar to the end users, let's not look at charging them for the subscription or devices and things like that. There are several other ways of building that in. And if we invert this and look and put the traditional models of revenues down and look at innovative models of making OEMs as partners and end users as consumers of services, then this technology will adopt much faster than the pace that it's taking today. This is my last slide. So though we talk about connectivity service, connectivity inside cars, it's much complex than bringing a hardware into a car. There has to be several pieces that has to be built, and we believe our fourth division addresses these specific needs, where we not only address the device inside the car, but we address all the requirements of the ecosystem members till the point of them being able to deliver services to the users. So that's my presentation. Thank you, and open towards questions.
Thank you. Has not been addressed by the speaker so far. Recently, we read how some security scientists were able to hack a car remotely. That was the Chrysler Jeep Cherokee. And after some initial investigations, it was found that it was the head unit which was the most vulnerable part of that car. And it was powered by Harman. So my question is, do you think that this car hacking problem has its roots in the head unit?
Anyway.
Sure.
It's my pleasure answering it. So the first thing is that the specific problem that we are talking about has the first problem with the carrier letting access into the car with an open network. So that was the first problem, and I think that was addressed in the press. But that said, are head units completely safe? Answer is, these head units were designed 7 years back. And 7 years back, security is not the primary problem that was solved in the head unit. And head unit is designed to operate in a trusted zone. Car is a trusted zone. The car network is a trusted zone. There is no authentication, or the level of authentication that's inside the trusted zone is very, very minimal. And the moment somebody got access to the trusted zone, they were able to get into many other parts of the car. So that's what happened in that specific case. And this is something that we anticipate more and more in the near future. With the connected cars and connected services becoming mainstream, this is one of the key problems that Harman is going to solve for the industry.
Any other question?
About OBD2. I assume you mean the information which is streamed, the data stream which comes from the control unit over OBD. Now, you also mentioned something about driver aids. So the assumption would be data from this adapter being sent to a backend, and the backend using some historical data of that vehicle sending back some information to the driver, maybe on his phone or something, that this is how you should drive or this is how you should not drive. Or maybe even localized applications on the adapter being streamed, which is communicating with the phone directly, so, you know, to save time, maybe more real time. So my question is, and if it's okay with you, I also ask this question to automobile manufacturers. Are there any concerns about the sort of overload or the information which is now streaming over the CAN? So we have a lot of control units over the engine control unit, which communicate over CAN with the engine control unit. So all this is already happening. They work in tandem. And now we have this OBD2, which is constantly plugged in, and this data being streamed. And as if you want to increase the accuracy of your driver aid, things like that, you want this information to be streamed as soon as possible, frequency or raster being as low as possible. There's a lot of data going to and fro. So are there any concerns about something failing or breaking? I don't know, just speaking it out loud.
Sure, driver assistance solutions. It has to be much more intelligent than displaying that the right gear for you to drive now is fourth gear, not third gear. That's what the systems do today. It's important to deliver contextual feedback to users, telling them that based on your historical driving performance, what we have seen is when you drive in the city, you probably use more of the second gear, and your car is capable of doing the same thing in the third gear. Maybe you want to shift the second gear to third gear faster. So this is the contextual experience that we are talking about. And addressing your other question about the OBD2. First of all, OBD2 is a connector standard. There is more behind the connector. And when you look at standardization among the OEMs in terms of the data in the OBD, it's limited. You have the very, very basic set of information available in the OBD, but beyond that, there is less which is standardized. And OEMs have a lot of concern in anything that gets plugged into the OBD port. It is a trusted zone again. The cars that were designed so far were not really designed with somebody consuming the data from the OBD port at every 100 milliseconds and then uploading it to the cloud. It was primarily designed as a diagnostic interface for them to plug their diagnostic tool and program the car rather than extracting data out of that port and then providing services to the user. There's a lot of concern, and it is important for us to educate them and to build our systems responsibly so that we don't really hog the port, but use the right amount of information from that.
No, good morning. My name is Venkat from Honeywell. In connector services, what kind of testing practices you follow in order to deliver reliable solutions to end customers? How do you test, and do you use any simulation? Because we have the networking problem. There are many things in real time.
Sure. So when we talk about connected services, there are again two parts. One is the connectivity part, and the connectivity to the internet part, and then connectivity to the smartphone part and the app experience itself. So when it comes to connectivity to the infrastructure, we rely on IoT tests that we do to get the base level of problems sorted out. Device-specific IoT, the smartphone IoT, and believe me, both are very, very challenging. Especially in country like India, the standardization level of equipments that are used by the telecom providers and also the type of phones that are used by our consumers are very, very different from the global markets. So when we deploy a global product here, we have an important problem that we have to make that work seamlessly with our operators and the Xiaomi's and other devices that our users are having in their hands. And the third one, which is actually the app experience, we rely on road tests. We rely on road tests for at least 6 to 7 months of continuous drive before we believe that it's ready for a user adoption.
Thank you. I want the audience to give a big round of applause for our speakers.
Thank you.